I knew months ago that I was going to be leading today, and I thought it would be open forum, and I'd have to keep you guys at your 5 minutes. But last week I found out that we're going to have a speaker. So that makes it easy on me. And but not only that, I was just excited when I found out who the speaker was, because I totally respect this man. I've known this man now for probably 5-6 years. He came out, God has called him to this valley. I have no doubt about that. And he searched out what was happening in the valley. He found the brew line. And he's a brew liner. I consider him a brew liner.
Amen.
And he has done great things. You never see a man with more passion for his ministry.
Amen.
And he is for the lost, the homeless, I've seen him in action, man. And he is definitely a blessing to us. And he is working God's work here, and he is being recognized by man for his, what he does. When I met him, he was Pastor Jimmy. But today I introduce Bishop Jimmy Rocha.
Well, praise the Lord for a great introduction. Amen. Thank you, Brother Craig. You still wrestle with them deer up there? Don't mind if I move furniture around, do you? I got to have a little room to operate. Amen. Hey, it's always a great time in the Lord at Brunei. Come on, Brunei, let's give God some praise.
I love
this
Brunei.
I know y'all see jackets and beanies and all that. You guys go, have to wake up. Come on now. Come on now. We're in the house of God. We're going to celebrate Jesus this morning. Amen. I thank God that we got to do a little Christmas worship this morning. Amen. I love this time of year, what it represents. As said and spoken, I'm the senior pastor of Liberty Temple right down the street. 13821 Osborne Street. Yeah, born and raised in the city of Pomona. Amen. The Lord has sense of humor, send me out to some little town called Arleta. Amen. Never heard of it in my entire life. Amen. But now I'm here. Amen. I was saved in 1995. I'm a product of the men's home. Somebody say the men's home.
Amen.
Yeah, that's where I came from. I was a dope fiend saved by the grace of Almighty God. I was once homeless living in a cardboard condominium. I have a prison number 6-0-7-3. I gave it back. God took it away. Amen. I am saved by God's grace. Come on, somebody. We are saved by God's grace. I've tried self-help. I've tried geographical cure. I've tried NAAA and no triple A. Bless God. But only by the saving grace of Almighty God, I'm able to stand today in the presence of you men of God. Amen. We are excited. I pray that you are excited about what God is doing. You know, my first time coming to Brunei was many years ago. This coming March will be my 10th anniversary, 10th year here in the San Fernando Valley Liberty Temple. And the first time I came to the Brunei, and I was honored to preach, I met Caesar for the first time in his box. Amen.
Uh-huh.
And I was blown away by beating that box, but he was just beating it up for the glory of God. Amen. I said, I got to get me a box of church. Amen. I got to get me a box. Amen. And we got one now. I don't ever see it, but we got one. Amen. Yeah, we got one. I see it in the music room. But one day we'll dust it off. We had a night of worship at our church last night. Amen. I have a Holy Ghost hangover, amen. He was jumping and shouting for Jesus last night. We had a celebration of praise at our church. As always, when I come to the Brunei, I say it open like this. I don't come and try to impress you with big fancy words because I know none. Okay? I got a GED in Wasco State Prison class of 94. That's what I know. I don't try to come and bring you something you never heard before. It'll woo you. Man, that was deep, bro. Because God is deep. You just got to know that, amen. You just got to be in his presence. Your Bible says it like this. In his presence is the fullness of joy.
Amen.
I come to encourage men. I come to challenge them. I believe one of the greatest gifts we can find in scripture is this. It's called the gift of exhortation. That means to encourage. That means to uplift, to challenge you, to charge you, to do better. How many know we can do better?
Amen.
We can do better. Amen. I'm going to talk to you today for just a few minutes on the topic of prayer. And I love men that pray, don't you?
Yeah.
We need to be around men that pray. Yeah. We can always do prayer better in our prayer life. Can somebody say amen?
Yeah.
We can always take our prayer life to another level. Because brothers pray like this, Lord, I need $2.85 by Thursday. Come on, Jesus. Amen. Yeah, but some of our, if you're married, I don't know about you, but I have a wife who's an ordained minister. And I get convicted by her prayers. Because I hear her in her room down the hallway, and she's tearing down strongholds. She's casting out demons. Now, she must be praying for me. But she's casting them out. She's praying in her heavenly language. She's doing it. And I'm in my study, Lord, help me get this word together. But we can take our prayer life to another level. So I'm going to pray the Lord's blessing over this word, and we'll get into this thing. Amen. Father in heaven, I thank you for these men of God. I thank you for this time of gathering. And I pray, Lord, that you give us a spiritual ear to hear and a heart to understand your biblical word of truth. Father, we pray this morning and we give thanks for your word. And we allow it to come forth with clarity and understanding. And we pray that you bless it. And in Jesus' name we'll say, amen, amen, amen. A very familiar story in the Bible, and I like to use it as my reference point today for prayer. The thought I have for you today is prayer, but I like walking through the story because it just does something for me when I look at the Bible. Amen. When I read stories, it reminds me of my life. I don't know if any of you have ever been incarcerated, but if you haven't, good for you. Amen. We're not proud of our walk in the penitentiary, but I've been in the penitentiary a few times in most of my adult life, but I spent a few years on the tier where I heard a whole lot of crying and not a whole lot of praying. Mm. But this story reminds us of a couple of men who pray in the inner courts. They're in the shoe program, but they knew how to pray. But not only did they pray, they did what we did this morning. They knew how to worship. We learned how to worship and pray. Consistently, and see, I messed up big words, but I don't even try it, Pastor. So I'm going to ask you to journey with me, if you will, to the 16th chapter of the book of Acts. And a very familiar story, as I say. Again, as I say, I never try to come and impress nobody with some deep theological type of a teaching, as much as I try to encourage the saints of God to take your prayer life to another level. I know that right now in our ministry at Liberty Temple, in just a few minutes, we'll be starting a prayer meeting. We have prayer meeting in our church every Saturday morning. Yours truly is the facilitator of that meeting. I believe in prayer. I believe we're all here because somebody prayed for us. Come on, somebody. When I was living in that cardboard condominium, each year was out of hubcap, my mom was praying for me. And the hound of heaven got a hold of this old wretched boy. Went to the men's home in 95. But we are here because somebody prayed for you. Somebody prayed you right into that seat you're sitting in today. Somebody called your name before the throne of grace, and God heard that cry, heard that plea. That's why you're sitting in God's presence today. We cannot be thinking like, well, I did this and I did that. You've done nothing, because the Bible says it like this. Apart from him, we can do nothing. All glory goes to God. Come on, men of God. Y'all need to wake up. Man, get that coffee back in the brew line. The of the Holy Ghost this morning. Amen. All right, let's go. Let's walk through the story a little bit, can we? Then I'm going to focus. I'm going to give a few points on prayer. Because I'm a firm believer in this. I will talk to you to death if you let me. Amen. But I know that men of God have. You got honeydews when you get out of here, right? You got to go cut the grass. You got to go clean the garage up. You got to, you know, clean the white walls on your motorcycle. Bless God. You got things to do, amen. I know. All right, let's go. Acts chapter number 16. When you're there, say amen.
Amen.
I'm beginning at the 16th verse in the Bible. Now it happened as they went to prayer. Went where?
Prayer.
Went to prayer. Okay, so we established they had a prayer life. They certain slave girl. Possessed with the spirit of divination, which is witchcraft, met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. This girl, somebody say this girl.
Yes,
some of y'all leave me that girl alone. Amen. I'm just going to leave that alone. Amen. This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, these men are servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation. I'm going to pull over right there for just a moment. Here are these two men of God. Now, Luke includes himself in the story by saying us. You guys are Bible students. You know that Luke is the author of the book of Acts. So he says they're going to prayer. This girl who had a spirit of divination, which was a fortune teller, which she had a crystal ball. She had tarot cards. She had all that stuff going on. But she was making money for them. And here comes these men of God into prayer. But I want to make note of this. And I want us to pay attention to this. How did she address them? She addressed them as servants of the Most High God. So even though she was from the enemy's camp, she recognized these are men of God. I come by to ask you early on this Saturday morning, does the enemy know that you're coming? Does the enemy know your name? Because I'm familiar with scripture, and it reminds me of a story of these evil spirits that approached these priests, and they said, Jesus, I know, Paul, I know, but who are you? I come by to tell you this morning. I'm going to try to wake you up the best I can, but you got to be able to know that when the enemy sees you coming, he got to know you are a servant of God, and he's going to get out your way. You are not be intimidated by the enemy. You walk into the enemy's camp and take back what the devil has stolen from you. This is how we do. I don't know about you, but I'm not rattled by the demons of hell. They're defeated. You know, at the cross on Calvary, they were defeated.
Amen.
Jesus disarmed the principalities on the cross on Calvary. Amen. So I don't understand why we get spooked and boo-hooed by the devil. Amen. You know what our problem is? It's called the flesh. Amen. It's called the flesh. The devil's been... The devil, bro. Oh, stop it. We know that it's our sinful, wicked flesh that's causing us a problem. We know it's the carnality of our mind that causes us a problem. We know it's our own stinking thinking that causes us the problem. We are so quick. And I helped a brother one time at my job a few years ago. He was a believer. Early in the morning, just like this. And he was at the microwave, beating it up. Kicking it, beating it, pounding on it. I walked in the room and said, hey, bro. It's like 6 in the morning. He started our shit. Bro. He was like, just see to me. The devil's already attacking, bro. Look at it. Already. I walked over to the microwave, flipped it around, plugged it in, hit 3 minutes, hit the start button. Ooh, there, I just slayed all your demons. What are you going to do with the devil? It's your approach and your perspective on how you view it. We get spooked. This woman, I pray that your scriptures are open. And it says it like this. These men are servants of the Most High God. I don't know about you. I'm humbled to be a bishop. I'm humbled to be a pastor. But I'm a servant first.
Amen.
I'm a servant first. I was trained with this mentality, men of God. I pray that you have it at your ministry. First in, last out. We got quiet. We got to get quiet. But first one out of the park, and I said, church, I gotta go. Oh, they'll get the chairs, they'll be all right. Somebody will take care. Oh, no, you be the best general colonel your church has. You get in there and help your ministry. You get in there and mop them floors and swap that deck. You a servant. Everybody want to preach. But we need to learn how to serve. These men are servants, the Bible says. They are servants. And that's how she identified. This is how we ought to be walking. When you walk into Walmart, you a servant. When you walk into Target, you a servant. When you at Home Depot buying that brand new hammer, you a servant. You a child of God. I come by to tell you this morning. Walk with integrity knowing who you are. Know who you are. You're a child of a king. The reigning king of Israel is who you belong to. You're a child of God. Don't let the devil intimidate you. Some of us walked around before we got saved like we was all that bad cheese puffs. Now, so we come to Christ with it.
Right.
Oh, child of God. Now, I don't say this. Let me explain this to you like this. There's a big difference between pride and arrogance and confidence. Don't walk pridefully. Don't walk arrogantly. But walk confidently. Because what your Bible says, Philippians 1 and 6 says it like this. Be confident of this very thing. That he who has begun a good work in you will be able to complete it till the coming of our Lord.
Hallelujah.
You walk in that confidence of who you are. You're a child of God. Don't worry about what society says. I don't care what society says. I got a D670730. It's in the archives of Sacramento, California. They can call me what they want. God says I'm an errant ambassador to the throne of Christ.
Come on,
Carol, I still get followed around. They still follow me around Macy's. They almost steal some. You know what's crazy? This I don't story tell. Bear with me. I'm one of the first principals. I get, you know, because I don't know why people think I'm going to steal something. I don't know why. Yeah, I just don't. Now, I can take it at Macy's. I understand that. They think, you know, somebody that don't fail. Yeah, you're going to steal something. I know. But I was doing homeless outreach on December 25th. I do it every Christmas. And I was at all places. The 99 cent store. I had a $100 bill burning a hole in my pocket that I need to go spend at the 99 cent store for the packages for loans. I went to the 99 cent store down there in Panorama City. Right there, right there, smack. Out of all places, loss prevention was with me in every aisle. I'm at the 99 cent store. I was like, come on, are you kidding me? I guess this toothpaste only 99 cents. I think I can afford it. I ain't going to put it in my pocket. I don't care what people think about this look and our appearance. What matters is this. What is the condition of your heart? Mm-hmm. What happened when they called David to be king? What did the prophet Samuel look at those men of God, David's boys? What was spoken to him? Men look at the exterior, but the Lord God looks into the heart of a man. Amen. Walk in the confidence of who you are, men of God. You are an ambassador. You are son of the Most High. Servants, they call them. All right, let's go. Verse 18 says it like this. And she did it for many days. Dad, let me come by and remind you this. Sometimes our little struggles and our tribulations last more than a day. There's this thing called endurance. We've got to endure hardship. Paul says it like this. We must endure hardship as a good soldier for Jesus Christ. Soldiers engage in warfare. Soldiers are enlisted in an army. We are the armies of the living God. Come on, somebody. We are the armies of the living God. You are enlisted in the army. Amen. You get me, bro. I'm glad you are. I'll talk to you. These other brothers are okay. They had no time out there this morning. Amen. Boy, I'm telling you. Where's George? I'm going to talk to George about
that. That's right.
George? Get these brothers some coffee up in here, man. Turn the air conditioner off or something. I don't know what's going on with y'all this morning. Listen. Said it like this. They did it for many days. Many days. These men were going to prayer. And for many, it was just a one-time deal. I don't know about you. For some, it was a struggle to get here this morning. Can we be honest? For some, the alarm clock went off. Sometimes it happens all Sunday morning. Sunday morning is not the easiest time. Midweek Bible study, whatever your ministry has you to partake in. There's an enemy that don't want you there. There's an enemy that don't want you there. That's why there's an interference. These men of God were on their way to prayer. There's always something trying to trip you up to keep you from coming to a brew line meeting, to keep you from getting up on Sunday morning. There's always something going on, and it's easy for us to get tripped up by those obstacles. But we got to be the bigger one. Because look how Paul addressed this situation. Paul dealt with it like this. He says in verse 18, it says, and she did this for many days. Somebody say many days.
Amen.
Oh, but here's Paul. I love this right here. This ought to be enough to put in your pocket tape home and you can walk with this for a little while. Paul became greatly annoyed and turned to the Spirit and command you in the name of Jesus, come out of her. In that very hour, it was gone. It was gone. But hear what Paul did. You guys understand scripture as well as I do. You know that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Paul spoke to the Spirit, not to the person. We got to stop judging and being critical about people and their appearance. There's a spirit going on. There's a war. It's called the spirit of the Antichrist.
Amen.
It's roaming rampant right now.
Yes.
There's a drug that's killing our kids right now that we got to be paying attention to. This fentanyl is going crazy. I did a memorial service last week. And I'm doing another one in 2 more weeks. This thing is killing our kids. We have got to be like Paul and be greatly anointed, be men of God who know how to pray fervency for our kids. And I know about you, but I got 9 grandkids and I need to cover them.
in this thing called prayer. I need to be greatly annoyed at the enemy. Say, get your hands off my kids. Get your hands off my grandkids. Get your hands off these men of God. This is where it starts with us. We are the priest of our home. We are the ones. We are the strong ones. Don't be calling on mom to take you to prayer. You need to give him the prayer. Mm-hmm. We need to be the men of God. Mm-hmm. And if you're single, you're still the priest of your home, no matter where you go. Greatly annoyed, Paul said. Paul got mad. Are you mad enough at the devil? You've got to be mad enough at the devil to want to take your prayer life to another level. You got to want to. You got to want to see. You got to want to see God move on your behalf. I don't know about you, but I get mad at the devil when I have to do these things. I bear a heavy burden. I bear a heavy burden for the loss of loved ones. I bear a heavy burden when I see people going through it. As a pastor, I get phone calls all the time. My son, my daughter, my niece, my nephew, my brother, they're hooked on this junk. They're getting 25 in life. They're getting struck out by the law, by the system. These things we got to be mad about. There's a devil running rampant right now. But the church want to play patty cake. I ain't got time for that. There's too many souls in the balance. This is why we ought not have reservation and our issues apart with any other men or woman or any person, because it will hinder our prayer. We got to have a clean heart. David said it like this: create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. We got to ask God to cleanse our hearts so our prayers are not hindered. Paul was greatly annoyed, and he turned to the Spirit. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, men of God. Our weapons of warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. We win the battles in prayer. We win the battles as we pray unto the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings and ask him to intervene in our circumstance. That's how our battle is won. Because I just turned 60 years old. I'm too old to fight anymore. So I got to go to prayer. Amen. I got to go to prayer. We can't eat the dogs loose no more. Amen. These in the senior citizen camp now, Buster. We got to go to prayer. Amen. And we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We can't be sizing up, folks. We can't be We go to prayer. We go to prayer. Paul became great. You got to be mad enough with the devil to get up in the morning when you don't feel like it. You got to deny that flesh. Remember what Jesus said in the garden? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is indeed weak. He told Peter, the sons of thunder, Peter and James, he said, James and John, sit over there. He told Peter, you sit over there, watch and pray for 1 hour, lest he fall into temptation. And us preachers beat that up. Oh, man, they fell asleep. We can't even pray for 10 minutes. He asked them to pray for an hour, watch and pray, lest he fall into temptation. And I was taught a long time ago, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, be careful how you beat up these men of God in your sermons. Because one day in heaven, they may call you on it.
Amen.
I always think about that when I think about Thomas. We call him Doubting Thomas. The Bible didn't call him Doubting Thomas. So preach my spirit to you. And that's in the story. Come on, get your best back. Verse 19 says it like this. And when they seen her, the magistrate saw her, the hope the prophet was gone. They seized Paul and Silas and dragged him to the marketplace and authorities. Verse 22, I'm going to jump down to 22. He says, then the multitude rose up together against him. The magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they laid stripes on them, they threw them into the prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, they put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. They was in chains. They was in the inner court. And if you institutionalize, know what that means. Administrative segregation. That's a shoe program. They were not a mainline. They were in the hole. They took them. But not only did they do that to them, they beat them first. For doing what? For proclaiming the way of the Lord. For proclaiming the name of Jesus. We're coming out of a COVID season. Well, I will say this. Be careful, because it's going around pretty bad right now. But there was a lot of talk about what churches are doing. And I don't know about, I can't speak for nobody else. But during the whole COVID season, I never stopped preaching Jesus. I never stopped doing. I got closer to Jesus than I ever was during the COVID season. Only by the grace of God, I never got it. I know a lot of people. I know a lot of people that walking in that talk about I'm covered by the blood. I end up doing their service. We got to be careful, be wise and not reckless. The devil never shut us down. that never, never shut. He may have shut some people down, but we have to know that when we are called to keep preaching and keep praying, they beat them, they whip them, and they put them in jail for taking this woman's money away, taking their money away, put them in the prison. But something happened to these men in prison. This is going to be the focal point of my thought for you today, is this. But at midnight, I love this. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. But at midnight, I want to tell you something. But at midnight, that could be for us any time of the day. But it says that they were praying. So they had already gotten beaten. They had already gotten whipped, and they had already gotten thrown into the shoe program. But if you remember the storyline, they were on their way to prayer. Somebody say they were on their way to prayer. So even their circumstance of being beaten and whipped and thrown into the shoot program did not stop them from what they contended and started out to do. Don't let the enemy ever try to keep you from what God has intended for you to do. They said, hey, we were going to a prayer meeting, so let's pray. Just because the enemy tried to stop us and create a hindrance, oh, I'm going to pray. Just because we're going through something, oh, I'm going to pray. Just because I'm getting hit here, getting hit there, my family's going through this, and I got to struggle here, oh, I'm going to pray. Just because this is going on, oh, I'm going to pray. We cannot let our emotions become a god to us and shut us down when we need to pray the most. Men are emotional, we just don't admit it. We got goofy emotions. It's called pride.
Amen.
Cut this bull. Well, you don't. You don't. We think we do. That's the biggest problem. We think we do. We need Jesus.
Yeah.
We can't do it without him. Oh, you can try. Oh, you can try. My best way of thinking got me a prison number and a cardboard box. My best way of thinking. Only by the grace of God. Listen, they were on their way to prayer. They were going to the prayer meeting. The girl shows up, causes a little problem. Some of y'all got a girl causing a little problem. You need to remember what you were called to do. You remember you were on your way to prayer. You were on your way to church. You were on the way to do what God's called you to do. But there was an obstacle. But they continued this. Who's going to prayer? Oh, I'm going to get my prayer. It's midnight. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. Their circumstance did not stop them from their call. Our circumstances cause us sometimes to get off focus.
Amen.
When the going gets tough, the tough turn to Jesus. Mm. The greatest thing you can ever do is turn your heart back to God and say, Lord, I need you. God, I need you. God, I need you. I can't do this, Lord. I can't do this. I have been through so much. I've been saved almost 27 years. I've been through so much in my journey. This season is probably the best I've had in almost 4 years. These brothers, some of these brothers, they came to visit me from the blue line down at the hospital at my worst. They was there for me. They was there for me. I about died in 2019 with this thing called ITP. I lost about 35 pounds, and I mean, because of they took a spleen out of me, and I got real sick. I've been through hell. I cried out to the Lord. Lord, you didn't bring me this far. Have me come out like this.
Amen.
I'm not going on. I pleaded with him. I cried out to him. I pleaded for this healing. And people prayed and believed. And today, I'm probably the healthiest I've been in a long time. A long time. My knees are sore today because last night I was jumping all over the place. I knew I was going to pay today, but it's all right. It's worth it. It's worth it. But we got to cry out to him. I knew I couldn't do it on my own. I needed the Lord. But in the inner courts, they pray at midnight. And then verse 26 says it like this. Suddenly, I don't know about you, but I want a prayer that shakes the foundations of the world. Don't you? I want that kind of prayer. Look what it says. Suddenly, the Bible says, suddenly there was a great earthquake. Oh, I want that kind of prayer. I want to praise God like that. I want to jump and shout like that. I want to pray so hard that the foundation of the world shakes. I want to know that I'm penetrating the throne of grace with my prayer. I don't want to feel that Lord empty. No, I want to pray, bless God. I want to tear down the strongholds, bless God. I want to believe God for the miracle, bless God. I want to see God's healing hand. I want to see the captain set free. I want that kind of prayer that shakes the throne of grace and let God move in our life. Get in there somehow, see you. I get in there. You guys are making me work, but it's okay. Listen. I don't know about this, you, and what your prayer life's like, but I pray that you take it to another level. These men were going through something. You and I are going through something for certain reasons, but whatever your deal is at home, whatever your circumstance is, you may feel as though I'm going through something. But take this storyline to understand this. Some of these dudes, they were beaten. They just were thrown in jail. They were beaten before they were thrown in jail. But it didn't stop them. It didn't stop them. We got to have that fighter's mentality. We got to have that soldier mentality. We got to be able to withstand. We got to be able to rise up. I love speaking to men of God because I'm a men's home guy. I directed a men's home in the city of Pomona for 8 years because I'm a product of the home. I didn't come into the faith in 95 as a backslidden Christian. I knew nothing about God. I went because I was homeless, hungry, cold, and alone. And the brother said to me, try the home. You've never been there. You've been through all the systems, you've been through all the programs, but you never tried this. And he said this words to me to probably save my life. He said, you got nothing to lose and everything to gain. They said, and if you don't like it, you can just leave. I tried it. 95. Tried it. Laid down my life for the cause of Christ, so that he can come in. Because I couldn't take the needle out of my arm. I know there's some dope fiends that say I kicked on my own at detox. Well, good for you. I've never done it. I've tried methadone. I've tried geographical cures. I tried other substitutes. I was never able to do it on my own. But God's grace and sovereignty, God's mercy in my life, he was able to do it. I didn't come in with a wife. I met my wife in church 26 years ago. I didn't come in with a car or clothes in mama's house parked in the backyard. I went to a home in 1995 with two things in my backpack. Well, actually, three. I had a can of stale Spam. It was stale because I lost the key. Remember the key? And I had two syringes, and one of them didn't even work. If you're a dopey, you know why you keep your syringes. That's money. That's how I went to the home. I had nothing. I had nothing. But this is why this fight's important to me, because I know that God has done a great work in my life, and all I ever want to do is show somebody you can do it too, because he just didn't do it for me. He died on the cross for all humanity so that we can have this new abundant life. But you got to want this city. You can't half-step God. He didn't half-step us when he carried that cross up the hill. You can't half-step him. You can't play church on Sunday and live like hell Monday through Saturday. It just doesn't work. All right, let's move on. Y'all looking at me kind of funny. Now I might do best for it. Let's go. Suddenly, the Bible says, suddenly, the foundation of the prisons was shaken. I want that kind of a prayer. I don't want that. Lord, bless my feelings. Amen. Ah! The doors were open. Call somebody. The doors were open. And whose chains were loose? Everybody's. Everybody's. I tell the church where I fellowship at this, if you don't know how to praise God, get it to somebody who does. It just might rub off on you. Especially as men, we go to God's house, I'm like, not you guys, that's a prayer. I love coming and saying, worship here. These brothers worship here. But some folks come to church. Me one of those y'all going to who's coming in, who's that? Who cares? You came to worship the Lord. Oh, when you spoke to those two-hitter quitters.
Come on.
Oh, zapping Rocha down. You didn't care. All of a sudden, you're a little reserve. Oh, stop it. Listen. They came, and follow the storyline here. Look what he says. He says this. The doors were open, and everyone's chains were loose. Why? Because somebody knew how to pray. Why? Because somebody knew how to sing. Why? Because somebody knew, I don't care about my circumstance. The God that I serve is going to set us free. I know that I'm changed by God. The God that I serve can break those chains of bondage. He whom the Son of Man set free shall be free again. He can do it. He can do it. Get around somebody who's going to help you understand this. Get around somebody who's going to, you can't, if you can't praise God, I pray that you learn how to praise Him. I pray with all that is within me. That you learn how to get into the presence of God with thanksgiving in your spirit. I pray that you learn this. He said, the doors were open and everyone's chains were loose. You talk about an outpouring of the Holy Spirit in the third tier by God. God was on the move. Because why? Because two men decided my circumstance ain't going to stop me. I'm not going to go to church with a tantrum. Church. And you're fighting with your wife, acting like you're doing God a favor by showing up at church. Well, I'm going to church. Yes. Oh, stop. It ain't about you. Church is never about us. Worship is never about us. It's always about Him. So we go to God in church on Sunday with our little emotion tantrum. No, don't do it to yourself. Get into His presence. Press into His presence. Adorn yourself with the garment of praise. The Bible says it will lift that spirit of heaviness. Get into that. Learn how to praise Him from all of your heart. The chains were loose and keeping the prison walking away from them, seeing the prison doors were open, supposed the prisoner fled. He drew out a sword about to kill himself. But Paul called and said with a loud voice, don't harm yourself. He said, we're all here. Verse 29 said, he called like mad, and men fell down trembling in front of Paul and Silas. And verse 30 says it like this. He's brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? This man saw a miracle. But who was this man? This man had just had him out in the outer court, beating and whipping on him. But there was a power greater than that that he was witnessing to. This man, this jailer, earlier in the story, was the one guy out there beating on this guy. Had him out in the inner courts, just whooping on him, locked him up. Now, all of a sudden, because the kingdom of heaven moved and the ground shook and chains were getting loose and the prisoners were hearing the other, them worship. Now, the jailer who was once beating on him, now wants some Jesus. He wants some of this Jesus. I'm going to tell you like this. If you know people that are skeptical about your walk with God, you keep walking. You keep being a light. You keep preaching Jesus and pointing them to the cross. They will come back to you one day and say, hey, tell me about this Jesus. Hey, tell me about this Jesus. I see the change in your life. But if you in 1 week and not the next, you in church 1 month and not the next, you in church 6 months and not the next, people begin to question your identity with God. But if you stick with this thing, people will see that the God that you serve is true and righteous. That's what the jailer saw. The jailer said, hold on. This guy that I beat on the court, they prayed. They sang a little shout to the Lord. Now all of a sudden, the jails were open. The doors were open. Everybody's chains were loose. There must be something to this thing. Yeah, it's called Jesus. It's called the Holy Spirit. Yeah, call the 7-Eleven and tell them to bring a couple of pints of black coffee, 40 weight down here. Bless the Lord. Yeah, it's all good. I'm giving you guys a hard time. That's what I do. Amen.
Amen.
But I'm serious about this deal. These men were serious too. They came at the midnight. Now, so I got three concerts. Guess I was done. That was just my opening.
Intros.
This is my opening, amen. Yeah, well, I once was at I was invited to an event. It was out in Fountain Valley, which is quite a ways away. When you drive from San Fernando to Fountain Valley, you want no time to preach, bro, Scott. I asked the brother, I said, hey, bro, how much time I got? He told me like this. He goes, well, you can go at about 9 o'clock, but the rest of us are going home at 8. Thank you, brother. Thank you for the warning. All right, let's go. Let's talk about prayer, and then I'll let you guys go cut your grass. Amen. How often do you pray? Inventory. And when I say pray, I'm not talking about, Lord, thank you for this day. I'm talking about intercessory prayer. I'm talking about on the behalf of somebody else. I'm talking about separating yourself in sackcloth and ash and into your prayer closet. I'm talking about that kind of prayer. I'm not talking about thank you, Lord, for this happy meal. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about, Lord, thank you for this. I'm talking about how often do you pray? How often do you enter into this course? How often do we do this, man? Because we're on the move. We got to be well summoned. We got to be moving. We're movers and shakers. I got to do this. I got to get this fixed. I got to get that done. I got to take care of this. I got to fix this. Well, this is crooked. I got to fix this. I got to take care of that. I got to do this. My wife needs this. I got to take care of that. I got to keep the kids working. Learn to make time for yourself, men of God. Learn to make time for yourself in prayer. The Bible says, Luke, in the Gospel of Luke, in the 18th chapter, in the first verse, Jesus said like this, in accordance to a parable. Men always ought to pray and never lose heart. It's a part of the makeup of who we are. I know I'm standing with a bunch of men of God who say in their spirit to me right now, saying this, oh, I pray, Pastor. Okay, I got you. I come out of challenge and take that to a whole other level. Not just pray a couple of people until you don't know what time I get up in the morning. And? Get up earlier. You know what time I start work? And what's the problem? What's the problem? So I start at 5, get up at 4. We are quick to make the excuse. Amen. Oh, you don't know what my day looks like. And? And? Because I'm old school. And I know that everybody can't relate to this kind of stuff. I understand that. My analogies are way out for some because they make no sense if you didn't live the lifestyle. But I was a heroin addict for 17 years. From the age of 17 to the 18 to the age of 35. And I knew this to be true. There was nothing that was going to stop me from getting what I needed when I was sick. But all of a sudden, prayer starts at what time? Come on, church folks, they just do this to me. I pray children's your pastor. Everybody knows that our church ends at 12 o'clock on Sunday morning. 12 noon, I try to do my best. I try to be right around 11:55, I start hitting them zippers on the fire. People closing their books. Hey! Hey, none! All of a sudden, we come to God and we want to do it on our terms. Well, we was down and dirty, we didn't care. I watched the Connections car in the rain. And convince them I can drive before the raindrop hits. I can do it. I'll walk across town in the blazing heat, 110 degrees, without a dime in the pocket. Think I know he's going to give me some credit. We went the extra mile. We wanted our jump. But we got to call unto God the same passion, fervent, and desire. We got to get in there and say, Lord, I need you. I'm not going to waste time here. You gotta pray. It wasn't playing out there. Now all of a sudden, man, oh, especially when you come from, you know, I want to.
Come on,
you
Remember when you was in the hood? Hood in there, homie.
You started walking like you.
Remember your feet.
And we just knew we was about something. Because we had 50 dudes behind us.
Come on.
We need God, man of God. We need the Lord. How often do you pray? How often do you pray?
Ouch.
If you're married, I admonish you to pray with your wife. Learn to pray with your wife. And if you got kids at home, let them see you pray. I was taught in seminary many, many years ago. This very important truth that was productive in my life. Keep the bedroom door cracked about yay much while your kids are in bed and let them hear you go to the Lord on their behalf. They're going to know where your trust and your faith is on. God protect them, children. Lord, protect them in the schoolyard. Protect them from the pressure. Protect my kids. Let some children see their faith in action. Don't just talk about it to them. Show them. Like the blind man says, show me. You got to show them what you're all about in action. Prayer changes things. Prayer, I can't promise you you won't get sick, but I can't promise you there is a healer. I can't promise you you won't go through struggle and or trial or tribulation, but I can't promise you there is a deliverer. We got to answer. We got to call upon him in prayer. Prayer changes things. Come on, men of God. Prayer will get you through some things that you couldn't do on your own. Prayer will get you to learn how to say no to some things that you used to say yes to. We need to learn how to pray and ask God to strengthen us. If you're struggling in any area of your life, as men of God, we suffer and struggle in a lot of things. It may be foolish pride. It may be lust. It may be an addiction. It may be a craving. It may be something. But God can take it. The biggest struggle that I had in my young Christian years, once God took the heroin, the frambles. I still shake. I hadn't had a cigarette in 26 years, but I still shake. Frambles. I didn't want frambles no more. I felt, you know what a locker smoker is? I was just got out of the home, Craig, and I was clean. I was happy. But I went to the room and I didn't know that the person I ran the room for was smoking flowers. I was like, when am I getting up to work? The whole house smelled like an ashtray, so who's gonna know? But then it began like this. I wanted to be a better witness. I was getting convicted. I was going to, the 7-Eleven was a half a block down from the church. And I would go to the 7-Eleven in the morning and I felt like I was at the dope house. I used to have the exact chains for a pack of GPC non-filter. I don't know if they make that junk in there. I said, hurry up. It's all right. I didn't want no church folks seeing me pick up. But I had to go to the Lord. I went to one of these evangelistic times, the evangelism deals. I know big churches do that stuff. Well, I went, a guest speaker was there, and it was altar call time. And he named out a whole bunch of stuff. He named out a whole bunch. You're going through this, you're going through that, you're going through this, you're going through that. Then he said this. Somebody here has a pack of cigarettes in their pocket. And the Lord wants you to be set free. I'm like, my first thought was this. Folks is telling, I'm doing it. Christians telling. Somebody's telling on me. Get a job at the bank, you want to be a teller. Holding on tight to my problems. And folks, he said, bring him to the altar. And people started moving from their seat. I was surprised. I'm like, man, I'd like to come up with some secrets here. Pride got in the way. I couldn't do it because the people I was with. But God was dealing with. God was dealing with me. And I stand before God and say this, and the truth of this story is this. I didn't take it to the altar, but I did do this. On the exit of the building, I walked into the men's restroom, dropped him in the trash can, and had a smoke since.
Amen.
He can change things. It must be a part of our daily routine. It says as they went to prayer many days, which suggests to you and I, they had a prayer life. We need a prayer life. The Bible says they went to prayer many days. This means they had an established prayer life, and they did not let it get away from them because of their circumstance. Even though they're in prison, they still continued to pray. They kept on with their doing. The Bible says in Psalm 55 and 16, it says, as for me, I will call upon the Lord, and the Lord shall save me. Hear me. Evening and morning and at noon, I will pray and cry aloud, and he will hear my voice. We have got to pray, men of God. We have got to pray more fervently. They had a commitment that absolutely stopped it. And I will say this. I'm going to move quickly, not set home. Listen. Have a prayer partner. Some accountability in your life. Get somebody you can call to pray. We need accountability, men of God. That I got this, I'm alone, I'm solo, this, that, and that. No. We need each other. The Bible says two are better than one. When one falls down, the other's there to pick him up. We need each other. That's why this blue line is effective for the men of God in this valley. We need each other. It's called accountability. It's a great thing to have. You need somebody in your life. I have a pastor in my life that he just called me yesterday. Talked to him for about an hour on the phone. And I laughed at my pastor. I love him to death. He trained me, raised me. I took him 17 years before he launched me out to Liberty Temple. And I tell him like this, Pastor, because he's giving me all, Jimmy, and this, and Jimmy, do that. And Jimmy, watch out for this. And Jimmy, do it. And I'm just soaking it in. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Then I kind of chuckled. And I said, hey, Pastor, you know what? What's up, Jimmy? I'm kind of growing up now, bro. I'm growing up a little bit. You know, I got that, but because he's so used to raising me up. He's so used to imparting to me. He's so used to helping, encouraging me, being a life speaker in my life. So I just take him. He's my pastor. I love him to death. Same man that sent me to the men's home in 95 is the same pastor that launched me out the Liberty Temple. Amen. I've only been to one church my entire Christian life. I don't have an experience of being in five different churches or three different churches. I think there's something wrong with that. I'm not trying to say that. My testimony is simply this, mine and my wife. We've been to one church. Liberty Temple is our second church. We stayed connected to the church that helped us.
Amen.
We stayed there through the good, the bad, and the ugly. Did I agree with everything he said and did? Well, certainly not. Did I backbite him? No. What I did was I prayed. I said, Lord, help me understand this man. Lord, help me. I was called to obedience, not sacrifice. Get somebody in your life that can be a prayer partner with you.
Amen.
Don't be alone in your prayer. I'm going to paraphrase the story for you for the sake of time. It says this. Well, let me do this first. James 5 and 16. 5:16. Y'all know the scripture by heart. I pray that you do. Confess your trespass to one another. One another. Amen. I had a young Christian come to me the other day. I love baby Christians. You know what? Because they're babies. And you love them. And you help raise them up. Sometimes you get around the old Christians, they just know everything. They got all the answers. They fall asleep halfway through your sermon because they heard it before.
Amen.
I get that. I'm okay with that. You know, but listen, I love the babies because they just are hungry. They're passionate. Pastor, how about this? Pastor, what about that? Pastor, can I do this? The gentleman came up to me and said this. He said, can I make an appointment with you? I said, yeah, bro, what's up? He goes, I want you to go into the confessional. I don't do that, but we can talk. We can talk and we can pray, you know, but that's a different denomination. I believe you're thinking of a Catholic church and you go in a little box and you do all them, you know, the Hail Marys and all that. I don't do that. Oh, you talk. But his question was sincere. He didn't know any better. I wasn't going to hurt that man's feelings. He didn't know any better. Love the babies. Love them. You got somebody that's around you that's younger than you in the Lord, do the best that you can to pick them up. See these two brothers right here?
These are my boys right here. Joseph and Daniel. Love them to death. Doing the best that I can to impart to them everything that I can and everything that I have. That's all I can do. The rest is up to them. But I'm going to lead by example, but accountability is important. Having somebody around you. Paul and Silas, in the 25th verse, it says this. Paul and Silas were praying. Notice the "and" there. "And" is a conjunction. It connects the two. Paul and Silas were praying. We need somebody in our life, men of God, that can keep us accountable. Confess your trespass to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Now, here it says, the effectual fervent prayer, righteous man availeth much. We need somebody. We need somebody for what I'm going through. And get to somebody that you can trust. Get to somebody. You've got to have somebody you can trust. You can pour your heart out into them. I pour more into this young man than he even realizes. He's just a good sounding board for me, but you know why? Because I trust him. You got to trust people. Amen. Because some people, you tell them, you put your heart on their lap, and next thing you know, it's all up in the third tier. I didn't tell you to go tell it, but it asked you to keep me in prayer. But sometimes we think as we put our heart in somebody's lap, it's for everybody to know. No, child of God. You got to find somebody that you can trust, that you can put your heart on their lap. They're not going to judge you. They're not going to be critical of you. They're not going to stereotype you. They're going to say, I got you, bro. We're going to pray.
Amen.
We're going to pray. We're going to lock arms and pray. And I'm going to do a follow-up. I'm going to see how you're doing with that. I'm going to call you back if you don't mind. We need this, gentlemen. We need this. We need each other. I'm thankful when I look at scripture. Now this story I'll paraphrase because it's rather lengthy, but it's okay. We've got enough time. It's too cold to cut the grass anyway. Listen. In Exodus, there's a story. It's my favorite. It's my favorite. Well, I got lots of favorites. He's here, you know. There's three men in the Bible: Moses, Aaron, and Hur. You guys know the story? Okay, I'm gonna read now. So you guys had your chance. You just said amen. Yeah, bro, I know it. Okay, well, Exodus chapter number 17, and I'll explain. I'll read it quickly and I'll explain. Exodus 17. So it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let his hand down, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became heavy. Men of God, our hands can become heavy. Amen. And when his hands became heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur supported his hands on one side and on one side and on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And if you continue to read that story, when they held his arms up, the children of Israel prevailed in battle. What is the story? What is the principle of that for you and I today? Sometimes you and I, men of God, need somebody to hold our arms up. We get tired. We need the uplifting. We need somebody to come by and pick us up and say, it's going to be okay. You're going to make it. Don't give up. Don't go worry about doing good. For in due season, you'll reap the harvest if you faint not. But we need somebody. I'm thankful I got men of God around me that can pick me up. We need to have that around us. Those men, they see Moses was, but every time they lifted his arms, the children of Israel prevailed in battle. But when he got tired, I don't know about you, I've been travailing in this battle a long time. I get tired. Church folks can wear me down. I get tired. I got 9 grandkids also. I get tired. But I'm thankful that I got men around me. They see my weariness and toil. They're able to say, Pastor, sit down and rest. We got you, Lord. We need this, man. We all need it. We need one another. And the Bible reminds us in Ecclesiastes that two are better than one. I reminded you of this. And in prayer, Jesus said in Matthew 18 and 19, he said this, again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst. Two are better than one. We need this in our life. And finally, I will challenge you to do this. Don't be silent in your prayers. The Bible says the other prisoners were listening. Do people hear you? People are listening. Your children, as I gave the example, I love going to the restaurant and pray. I include the waitresses already. Come on, we're going to pray, join us. It's okay, you. Join us in prayer. Be vocal in your prayer. Remember how the scripture is laid out for us. The other prisoners were listening. Can you imagine what they're going through? I don't know what their charges were. The scripture doesn't teach us. But here's what I do know. I want to be an example to men of God like this. When I go through hell or high water, I want people to see my faith in action. I don't want them to see me ball up in a corner, poor Jimmy. I ain't got time for that. I share this all the time. I wish I had time to pull over and lick my wounds, but I don't. I got to fight this thing. I got to battle this thing. We ain't got time for self-pity or woe is me. We have got to allow our prayers to be verbal and vocal, let people know, by God, I'm praying. It's okay, men of God, to say this. You're darn right I'm going through hell right now, but the God that I serve is able to get me through this hell. You're darn right I'm not feeling good, but the God that I serve is a healer. You're darn right things are going wrong, but God, that's not who God is. Yeah, I ain't got no money in the bank, but the God that I serve is a provider. But we go through something, we shut down. Don't do it. Don't do it. I'm going through it. I can't. Yeah, I'm going through it. And? Ain't you? I'm going through it. What you in the club? We're all going through it. It's part of the makeup of who we are as men of God. We are going to go through it. But God will get us through it. He'll get us through it. Be vocal. 2 Timothy chapter number 2 and verse number 8, your Bible says it like this. I desire therefore that men, somebody say amen, amen. Pray everywhere. Read your scriptures. It says everywhere. Everywhere. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation. I'm going to pray. If I didn't care what people thought about me when I stood in front of a 7-Eleven, begging for nickels and dimes just to get a cup of noodles. By God, what should I care what you think about me praying in the public square now? Begging for money out there in the cold streets. Why would I care what people think about my prayer? Society don't want it. I feel sorry for them. I'll pray for them too. Be vocal in your prayer. Rejoice in the Lord always. Paul says to the Thessalonican church, he says in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Don't stop. Jesus had a powerful prayer life. Jesus, there's only one thing the disciples of old asked Jesus to teach them, and that was to pray. They didn't ask him to teach him how to cast out demons. They didn't ask him how to deliver the sick. They asked one thing. Lord, teach us to pray. One thing. Jesus often went to the mountain alone to pray. We need to pray. And finally, for sure. I said finally like three times, right? So this is the finally for sure. Add some doxology to your prayer. That simply means is this: worship when you pray. Remember what they did. Read the context. Go home and read the story again. They prayed and they sang. The two go hand in hand. Worship, God, just don't go to the Lord and glory. I know I always say $2.35, maybe that was a pack of cheapies and not Lord, $2.35 by tomorrow. Worship him. Sing him melodies and spiritual songs and hymns in your hearts to God. Sing him. Add doxology to your prayer life. Sing to the Lord. Worship him. Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns unto the Lord. Don't just pray. Learn how to sing. You men sing good. I heard y'all this morning. What was that Christmas song we sang? Saturday night? What's it called? Y'all, man, sound like a choir, man. Like one of the big old choirs. The robes on, the angels singing. Y'all know how to do it. You know how to do it. You got to sing to him. Sing praises unto him. I love to praise God. I love to. I'm not even on the choir or the worship team at the church, but last night I told me not to make moves. I like to get up here and sing, bless God. I turned the microphone off, of course, because I can't sing today. But my God, I love the praise of God. Add it to your prayer. Spend some time in worship. Don't be so much in a hurry. Make some time to pray and just go into singing. Sing a melody in your heart to God. The Bible says in Colossians 3:16, let the word of God dwell richly within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Add some singing to your prayer. Add some worship. It invites the presence of God. It opens the throne room of heaven. Just don't go to the Lord and simply pray. Remember the two things these men of God were doing. They were singing hymns and praying. Add it to your prayer life. Take your prayer life to another level. I don't know what your favorite worship song is. I don't know what your go-to worship song is. But I pray that you have one. I'm old school. I'm a Ron Canole kind of a guy. That's where I go. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising it. You know. Yeah, that's Sunday morning when I'm getting ready to go next door to the church house. Ron Canole, lift him up. I don't care how many times I've heard it. Because let me tell you why. Every time it's a new song.
Amen.
Right here, it's a new song. You've got to have one. I don't know what your favorite song is. Make your own that belongs and glorifies God.
Amen.
But add it to your prayer. And my fifth finding. only because I'm getting hungry. David knew how to pray and sing. You guys know.
Yeah.
The Lord is my shepherd. Oh, I sing that. But my favorite, I will say my favorite, because the whole Bible is my favorite. But
amen.
One of my favorite verses, a passage that reminds us of a combination of the two, is found in Psalm 34, in verse number 4. David says this: I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around all those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. That's what we do. We trust in him. I come by this blessed Saturday morning to charge you and challenge you to take your prayer life to another level. Don't let circumstances stop you. Don't let obstacles hinder you. The more you go through, the harder you press in. Be vocal about your prayers. Don't be ashamed of your prayers. Pray with your family. Be the one at Christmas time. I don't know where your Christmas celebration will be. Wherever you go, be the one to say this. Before we go to the tree and bust open those gifts, can we talk about Luke chapter number 2? Can we be reminded that the Bible will teach us that the shepherds are watching over their flocks by night, and the angels appeared unto them, and they were greatly afraid. And they speaketh unto them and say, do not be afraid, for unto you on this day in the city of David a Savior has been born, and he is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign to you, and you'll find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in the manger, for there was no room at the inn. And suddenly the angelic host of heaven began to sing, glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth, and goodwill towards all men. Add that to your Christmas celebration. Put Jesus first, because he is the reason for the season.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's give God some praise. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray for every man in the sound of my voice, God. And Lord, as we learn and heard and glean today, Father, about prayer, Beginning with myself, Lord, I pray, God, that you help us to take our prayer life to a whole other level, God. Lord, that we would not be complacent, God, in our prayer life. That we would know, God, through struggle, through storm, through trial, and our tribulation, God. To learn to pray, turn to you, God, the way maker, the miracle worker, the healer, God, the deliverer, the sanctifier of our soul, God. We turn to you, God, in time of need, God. But not just in crisis, Lord. We pray unto you, God, just to honor you and give thanks to you. To thank you that you are the reigning King of glory. Thank you that you are the Rose of Sharon and the Lily of the Valley. Thank you, Lord, that you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Thank you, Lord, for who you are, the Lion of Judah. We thank you, God, that we can make this proclamation in our prayer life, that we can add a spiritual psalm in our prayer life, God. That we can sing melodies unto you, God, as men of God. That we're not ashamed of who we are. That we can pray more fervently. That our families see our faith in action as we pray. That our loved ones see us pray for their needs. That those that are hurting see us believing you, God, for their touch. We are people of prayer, God, and we thank you for this, Lord. But as we learn today, men always ought to pray and never lose heart. Teach us, God, not to go weary while doing good. For oftentimes we pray, Lord, and we don't see the result. But as David would say, I would have fainted unless I would believe and see the hand of the Lord in the land of the living. We know, God, that you're a miracle worker. We know, God, that you're able. We know, God, that you can do it because you've done it in our lives. And we're going to continue to pray. We're going to continue to pray harder and longer and more fervent, God, as you challenge our spirits today, Father. Bless every man, God, every family that they represent. I speak a blessing over them, God. I speak a blessing over their Christmas celebration. I pray a blessing over their family, their children, and their loved ones, God. Keep us at peace, Lord. Keep us at peace, God. We know without a doubt, Jesus is the reason for the season. And we thank you for this, Lord. And today, God, we'll be careful to give you all the praise, honor, and glory. And in Jesus' name, we'll say, amen. Yeah!